Back to Bllackkoutt TV. We're here with Verquan, the show, Kimbrough. What up, man?
What up, Brody? What's up?
Oh, man. You just don't know, bro. You are one of the most exciting fighters from Pittsburgh, bro. I mean that because you got a lot. You got Paul Spatterford. You got Marty. You got Eddie Chambers, who now say he ain't from Pittsburgh. He's from Philadelphia, but man, look,
he's from
Homewood. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, he a Pittsburgh boy.
Right, but
I don't care what he say. He can say whatever he want to say. He a Pittsburgh boy. Shit, I was in the gym. I grew up in the gym with him, so he a Pittsburgh boy.
Exactly. Well, you know, he got a little money, and he figured he ain't from Pittsburgh, so you know. But we here to talk about Verquan Kimbrough, the show. Since this is your first time here on Bllackkoutt TV, man, let's go ahead and start from the beginning, like way back. Like let's go way back.
How far back? Amateurs?
Nah, let's go back as far as your first street fight.
Oh, street!
See, you ain't there. You nobody. See, I've been seeing all your other interviews, and they can only go back so far with you. But I know you, so I know you can go further back than that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I can go back. I had some street fights, man. Listen, I used to really get into this fight with this guy, this kid. He passed away. Well, he died. I'm not sure. I think he got killed. His name was DeJuan McKenzie. He should live. I live in this little I live in Bllackkoutt, but Bllackkoutt has a dad park, you know, or a troubled park, and then right. the good park. The park that I grew up in was, you know, was a better part of,
like, a suburb part
of Bllackkoutt. I don't want to say it was a suburb, right? Because shoot, five minutes and I'm up on a hill, but I live in a place called Plant 12 in Bllackkoutt. And at the time when we moved up there, we were the only black family that lived up there. My mom's Italian and black. So she has some Italian in her, and we moved up there, and we were the only black family up there. The first black family in a place called Plant 12. Now, everybody live up there now. But
Was that a rough fight?
No. It was my first fight ever, you know, for me to listen, to see where you line up at on the food chain. You get what I'm saying?
Right. Like,
wait a second though. Let me say this though. Cause I have three brothers. So I come from a family of three boys, three girls. But my father had outside children, so it was only three boys that lived in the household with me, and I was the youngest. So I had an older brother named Ronique, and the other one named Michael. They call him Nashe. So growing up with them, man, they beat me up, bro. They They whoop on me, but I always wanted, I always wanted to be like my older brother, especially me and Nashe probably was the closest because, we shared the same room. Right, my oldest brother, he was so much. He was older than us. He was 6 years older than me, 3 years older than him, but. He was the first one in his own room, but me and the younger, since I was the younger brother, I had to share a room. Me and my brother had to share a room. And so we had twin beds. We had those twin beds in there. And we had to share a room. And, me and him just became very, closer than any of us, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, like, and see, I know what you're talking about. Because in Pittsburgh, man, you said, you got to see where you are on the food chain. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you got to see where you are.
But also, you need to have that first fight, street fight, to put the taste in your mouth. Because if you ain't taste your own blood in your mouth from getting punched in the face, bro, then you ain't ready. You know what I'm saying?
Well, the first, if you want to take it that way, well, the first fight I got into was my brother was whooping my ass. That's it. my brothers whooping me up. You know what I'm saying? I probably done so well in boxing and in just in life in general because I am a younger brother. So I got like first examples on what not to do, how to fight, the other thing, because they were all lead examples. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Personal lead example. They're inside the household with me, so I had to personally get to see. Oh shoot, I'm not gonna do that. I just seen what happened to him. I'm not gonna do it. No. So I had a prime example. That was the first example on,
what not to do.
What not to do. Yeah. Things on what not to do.
Okay, and not just now, the, now,
it was, huh?
Now, as you started getting towards like eighth grade, that's like middle school. So eighth grade, that's right when you started. You had to start.
Wait a second. So let me say something. Because before I got into boxing, I was a wrestler.
Oh,
I used to wrestle. Yeah, I used to wrestle. Man, I won states, Wawa's, all of that.
What?
And the reason, because my older brother was a wrestler. So both of them were. They were both, they were wrestlers. So Alakupa used to have a wrestling team, and they was wrestling on that team, and then I used to follow because I'm younger, so I used to follow my bigger brothers around, and since they were on the team, automatically I used to act like I was on the team, I was a mascot for the wrestling team. Alakupa wrestling team back then was a mascot. And they had me a singlet. I used to come home telling my mom how I won my match that night and stuff. My imagination at the time was going. And they say it take a village to raise a child. I had multiple villages that raised me. My mother and my father and my brothers, my siblings, and the household I lived in had a lot to do with my development as a man today and as a man, as a child growing up. They had a lot to do with it.
So now, okay, you say you had like a village to raise you, which is pretty much, that's how it was back then growing up.
Oh, yeah.
Cause you can't do that now. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like you try to tell somebody's kid to get out of the street now and pretty much gotta fight their own family. You know what I'm saying?
Well, so, I think it's the approach to I think a child's going. I think it's their approach on how you tell how a person tells the child, because you gotta realize a lot of times people just before you used to go out and you could just yell at the child and it was acceptable. You know what I'm saying? Yelling at the child, the parents seeing you yelling them to protect the child, it was acceptable. But now, you know, now you can't just yell at a child like, yo, get out that street. Or do that, you know, there's a reason why you may be yelling at him to get out of shape. But now you probably got to go, hey, wait a second. Don't go on that street. because there's a car that's coming around there, or this, you know, there's something over there and I don't want you to get hit. You know what I'm saying? Approach, the approach got to be different. That's all. You still can do the same stuff. A lot of time. A lot of times, the way somebody presents it, you got to be mindful on how you say stuff now these days.
Right, right.
Well, the message is still the same, though. The message is still the same.
Now you say you won state in wrestling, so you was just pretty much athletic from the beginning.
I come from an athletic family. My uncle's Tony Dorsett.
Whoa, what did you just say?
My uncle was Tony Dorsett, so I come from an athletic family. My dad played, my dad and Tony Dorsett ran, played for Hopewell. They were, you know, my dad was, Tony Dorsett was the running back, and my dad was the, wing back, that's what they call it. They ran in the backfield and they played together. And Tony Dorsett went on, he went on to pursue football. And my father, he got into them girls. Daddy went the other way. You know what I'm saying? But
hey, that's what's up, man.
If he didn't, I wouldn't probably be here.
Now, did you play any other sports?
Yeah. I played basketball.
Was you any
football,
good?
Football was one of my favorite sports before boxing. Because I was good in football.
What position you play?
Tailback. Running back. And then, because my body wasn't growing, you know, I went from running back to wing back. The first one, you know.
Right.
But my best position on the football field, cornerback. Oh, shut down. Shut down cornerback. Listen, if my height, my height wasn't going with my athletic ability.
Right. I
wanted to be a football player. So I had to listen. So I'm good in football. I'm still playing football, and I was boxing. So I was doing all these different sports, you know. But when a sport wasn't around, like if basketball wasn't in season, I'd be boxing. When football wasn't in season, I'd be boxing. You know, I ran track. When track wasn't in season, I'd be boxing. And track helped me out for boxing too. But I came from an athletic everybody in my family, on my side of the family, the Kimbrough side of the family, they're all athletes. They were all athletes. Yeah.
So when you jump into the, you said you was playing football.
Hold on, my little cousin right now is in the WNBA. Her name is Shatori Walker Kimbrough. She's in the WNBA right now.
For what team?
Mystics, Washington Mystics.
What?
Yeah.
We're going to have to interview her, man.
Yep.
We're going to have to interview her, man. She's doing good?
Yeah.
She start?
Of course. Shit. Yeah, we are still at the. We ain't playing no sport when we started. So, we're
in there. All right. Okay. That's that.
And on that football field, I was a hitter, too.
Okay. Hey, so you said you was playing basketball, football, or boxing. So boxing came in around the time you started playing that?
By the time I started playing what?
Football and basketball.
No, boxing came in during wrestling season. It was a guy on the wrestling program. Okay, so I was like a mascot because there wasn't no little kids wrestling. So I was, you know, a little boy. I'm young. I'm trying to follow my brother. I'm following my brother, and my brother was really good at wrestling. And it was a guy on the wrestling team named Scott McCracken. Rest in peace to him. He passed away. He was on the wrestling team, and he boxed. And the coach that trained him, the boxing coach that trained him, they had a wrestling meet. And the boxing coach came to the wrestling meet, and I was there. And I was, you know, warming up with the – I had my singlet on and stuff like that. I ain't never, you know, warming up with the – practicing on the mat with all the guys. And my brother and all those guys, and he seen me. And he seen, you know, you take a little kid that's, you know, obviously I had athletic ability, but that thing need to be nurtured too. So you take a little kid that's interested in doing sports and is willing to, you know, willing to do the work, and he can't even play yet. Something special about that boy. You get what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying? Listen, because I didn't have to be. I could have been out playing with some kids or something, running around. But I'm in a wrestling gym on a wrestling mat, wrestling with the older guys. You know, faithfully and dressing up, had me a singlet and everything. You know what I mean?
Trying to learn some shit.
Yeah, I was so. I think now that I look back and now I'm wiser, I look back at it and be like, man, the coach seen something. He seen that kind of, man, that kind of drive and determination for something that he can't even compete yet. And he out here trying to do some type of activity, you know. And he followed me every, man, he used to show up every day to my house and talk to my mom, just trying to get me to box, you know. Man, I want to show you how to box. Come on, I want him to teach him some boxing, have him come out of box. And because I wanted to go to the NFL. I ain't going to lie. I thought I was going to be a football player. But, because I was that good, I was good at football. But my size... wasn't my structure, it just wasn't happening for me, you know?
How tall are you?
I'm about 5'6", 5'5".
Oh yeah.
And I was little. I'm 100.
Would have had to put on a good 100 pounds to go to the NFL.
Yeah,
you would have played running back.
So he seen me started coming around, so I was just going down there practicing. He would bring me up just to practice and show me some stuff. And I was picking it up like a sponge. That's what the term he used. I picked it up, it came natural. Boxing came natural to me. And not only that, I come from a family of fighters. My family's, they, you know, they street fight. They were fighters. They, you know, they could fight.
Yeah, but only you the one can say you was the champ, you know what I'm saying?
That is true. That is true.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yep.
Now, Now, when you started in the amateurs, like, let's go back to your first five amateur fights. Because you know the first five amateur, all right, let's go back further than that. Your first two amateur fights.
My first amateur fight.
Was you swinging wild?
Huh?
Was you in there swinging like out of control?
Nope. Listen, what? No. I stopped the dude. I stopped him. But I still got, I think they got it. I got a tape somewhere. But all I did was throwing straight, just like this. Just straight. And I stopped him. And it was like the dude wasn't even trying to block him. He was just hitting him. I was young. I'm 11 years old. All I did was, I just kept just punching him in his face. And that was it.
You fell in love with it after that, didn't you?
Yep. That was it. That was it. I was like, man, oh yeah, I guess I'm hooked in. I got a W, you know what I mean?
Hey, that fight game, man, that's a lonely game, man.
Oh yeah, by far.
That's a lonely, man. You doing road work, you feel lonely. You can't have nobody out there with you. You know what I mean? Nope. It ain't like running with a bunch of friends, man. It's like,
man, listen. It all goes away after, you know. Look at me now. You know what I'm saying? I'm still looking for the people who walked me to the ring. I don't even know who they were. Some of the people. I don't even know how they got in the fight. Some of them. You know what I'm saying?
Look, okay. Let's. All right. Now, in the amateurs, the coach always say to everybody else, listen, there's only one voice in the corner. Only one voice in the corner, and that's your coach.
Yeah.
Nobody else, he won't allow nobody else to say nothing else to you.
Yeah, but you can identify that his voice. I mean, at least I could.
I mean, you're going to have people screaming, you know, but like when you train with somebody for so long, it's like you can hear his voice at the million man march.
Correct. But you know not that, I mean, listen, because when you're in the heat of the moment, it's hard to try to, listen, you better hope you hear something that he say, because when you're in the heat, you fighting, you're in the heat of the moment, man,
hear that shit when you're in the ring.
Hell no.
When you're in the ring, you got to go off of what you've been practicing.
Yeah, listen, I don't care what nobody say. I don't hear nobody's voice when I'm in.
The only voice I used to hear was my opponent's voice.
Yeah.
That's it. I need to hear him. If he squeal when he get punched, like if he be like, like if he squeal when he get punched, or he lets some air out of his mouth when he get punched, that's what I'm listening for. Like, you know what I'm saying? I ain't listening. I'll listen to the coach when I sit my ass back down.
Yeah. Yeah.
But when you get up to, because you had like 100 and like almost 150 amateur fights.
Man, yeah, somewhere with like 200.
God.
50, yeah, 200.
You had as many amateur fights as Eddie.
Yeah.
And Chambers, and he had like,
Well, when I made the Olympic team, they didn't make it. But that's how when he turned professional. But we traveled to, I think he was on a couple of tournaments. I think he lost though at one of the tournaments. He would always lose early in the tournament.
Did he lose at the regional?
Yeah, he would always lose early, like the second round or the first or second round, he would always lose. But yeah, really, listen, at that level, they had their picks. You know what I'm saying? Like those board of people but they had their picks on who they like in a fight or who they want. Even though we're fighting, like the judges and stuff, they know who they want, like who they want to see go. And I was just one of those picks where I think I had knocked somebody out, and that's how they started to get me to pick me. They knew I could fight, but I had knocked somebody out, and then I got on the side of all the judges, you know. Because they're trying to get up a Olympic team so that we can all be, you know, so we can win some, I guess, some titles there to the Olympics.
Well, you won the silver, didn't you?
Yeah, I won silver, and I won one of the biggest nationals they made, the U.S. Open Nationals. The Open Nationals, everybody in the United States. So I won that. I won that one. So anybody that was in my weight class from 135 in the United States, so you still got the medals? Huh?
You still got your medals?
They somewhere. They somewhere in the basement. I can't eat medals. I can't eat medals, brother.
Right.
Them medals is, you know, they got a story behind them, but man, you know, at the end of the day, this kid cash is king.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel you on that, man. I feel you. You know, Muhammad Ali said the same thing, man. He said when he won his gold medal, he came home and he went to a restaurant and he sat down in a white restaurant and ordered some food and they treated him just like a nigga. So he, I remember that time we were sipping on wine. I could see it in your eyes, you were feeling alive. I'll tell you I was good, but I thought what I like. I'm used to singing twice, baby, I shouldn't drive. I should let you on the keys, baby, take me aside. If you take my advice, baby, then you survive. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. We had a little bit of technical difficulty. That was my bad. I should have turned my phone off. Sorry about that, Verquan.
Nah, you good.
But Muhammad Ali, man, he said they treated him like a nigger. And he said he walked out of the restaurant, went straight to the river, and threw his gold medal in the river.
Yeah, the times was different then, though.
I mean, but it well, not really. Because if you think about it, they care for you to be good, but then my whole thing went out. See, when all right,
yeah, two types of fans.
When I was playing sports, my thing was they love you when you're good, they don't remember you when you're not playing anymore. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, but you can't. I mean, no, I see what you're saying, but you can't. That's a part of growth.
Yeah, it's a part of growth, but it's like. It's like we're a prize animal. It's like they betting on us. You see what I'm saying? It's like they betting on you to be a pit bull, but then all right, I'll give you a prime example.
It's a business though.
I'll give you a prime example. Paul Spadafer, right?
Yeah.
He was doing good when he was out there, he was doing his thing, he was active, he was doing his thing. Right? Did you see that news report where he was in a bar?
Oh yeah, and that lady
and he was drinking and he beat that old lady, threw her to the ground.
Yeah.
They blew that shit all out of proportion. Blew that shit all out of man, come on.
No. I understand what you're saying, but you gotta look at it on both sides. And so when somebody tell me a story like that, I look at it both sides and then listen to. So I got different b- beliefs. I got religious background. So I'm religious beliefs. And when I got to look at both sides, and I got to choose what was right and what was wrong.
Right.
And I'm always choose what's right and what's wrong. I'm always going to choose the, you know.
Well, I choose to say he was wrong.
By far, 100%. 100%.
I'm not saying he was wrong as far as the lady. I don't know the situation. I'm saying he was wrong as far as being in that bar prior to that lady. Because in the bar, they said he was challenging everybody in the bar to fight.
Correct. Well, I don't know the story, so I know.
This was the, I just saw the news. I just saw the news clip, and that's what I'm saying. The witnesses in the bar said that the news was they're interviewing when it happened. So they said he was inside the bar drinking. They said he had two drinks, and he started challenging everybody in the bar.
Yeah, but he probably was drunk before he even got there.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
But you can't put yourself in them situations.
When Paul isn't drunk and he's on his and he's boxing, and, you know, he's a good dude.
He's a good dude. I bet.
And he can rumble. Can't take no problem. Listen, at the end of the day, he is the only one in the Pittsburgh, to hold the IBF and the WB. I want to say C.
That's what I thought it was, the WBC.
The WBC and the IBF. He won the IBF too.
Well, but yeah, but you held two belts yourself.
I held the IBA world title. I had seven of them, but I had one that was a world title, but it wasn't as recognized as like the main four, WBA, WBC. I had WBA, but it was like. So they have they create these belts. There's a WBC. It's like the super champ, and then they got like an IBA or something like that, and it's like a smaller belt before you fight for the bigger belt.
It's like
that whole belt thing is a scam. It's all bull. Anyway, listen, the person who the champion is how many people you got to come see you fight. How much money going? Listen, this world is ran by money. Don't let it fool you. Listen, whoever get the most money is the winner. Floyd Mayweather is controlling the boxing game right now, bro.
Yeah.
Listen, he got two fighters fighting each other. They his fighters for the title, and who any one of them win, he don't care if they any one of them lose. He keep them both. What do you mean? It don't matter.
That's what Don King did to Tyson and
that's right, yeah.
Tyson, and when Tyson lost his fight to Buster Douglas.
Yeah, correct. He don't really, you know, he don't care. Yeah, he got probably a favorite to pick and one of his homie, but in reality, if the homie get beat up, who cares? I still got the belt. What do you mean?
Right. But hey, let me ask you something, man. Let me ask you a question.
Go ahead.
Now, back when you was training, you used to come down and spar down in Wilkinsburg.
Yeah.
Wilkinsburg, Pennsylvania. For those who don't know, this is in Pittsburgh. For those of you, I mean, for when you used to come down there and spar, you were sparring Monty.
Correct.
What made Monty start thinking that he was... I mean, he was saying some disrespectful shit, man.
Well, Monty got a way of doing a lot of people, you know.
Because he was like, yeah, Verquan.
Monty got.
He ain't in my way. He ain't in my way. He just to stop on the way. So I can go get the big belt. I'm like, wait a minute. Yeah. I understand Yeah, you ain't see that interview he did?
No, I did see it. Yeah, I went on after that and did an interview after that. But listen, I think I think Monty had a. I was learning the boxing game, and Monty was promoted. So Monty was signed. So okay, this is how it all. I can tell you the whole story here. All right. So how it was when I turned professional. Yankello, Tom, which is my trainer, they all started a promotional company, in which I, since I had the contract down in Mountaineer, of course, I owned part of the promotional company at the time. When you know, and then we started signing other fighters, and Monty was one of the fighters,
right.
Okay, so we talking about Floyd Mayweather was doing. That's the same thing that Yankello and all those guys wanted to do too, but on a smaller version. They didn't. Me and Monty was never going to fight. First of all, we were never going to fight.
Why not?
Because of the weight class, Monty was too little. I couldn't the weight class. Me and Monty fought the amateurs.
So you was what, 140? He was 135.
He was littler than me. Yeah, he was little.
No, he was 130.
He was 130, but I went there. My body couldn't get little no more. Monty's naturally smaller than me. Naturally, you know, like he's shorter than me. But when he were boxing, he can get smaller than I could get. And then, I mean, now his family, he's big bone. His family is big, you know, they're bigger. They're husky type family. You knew he was going, eventually he's going to blow up. Without boxing, I don't know what he looked like now, but I can imagine he put on some weight. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's in his family. He was going to blow up. But I was learning the boxing, the business side of things, as well as so it was Verquan the fighter and Verquan the promoter. You get what I'm saying?
Okay.
I had a contract down there at Mountaineer, but that put everybody, all the fighters in Pittsburgh, I was able to put all the fighters on the cards to help them get wins. Eddie Chambers fought on that card, on a card with me. They put all off. You know,
how come you ain't get me on that card?
Yankello and them was handling it. So that's what I'm telling you. When I signed with Yankello, it was like you know, we had our own little promotional company, and I own 25%. Of the promotional company. So me and Monty would have never fought unless I had won like a big, it came like a real star attraction, and Monty would have came a real star attraction. So you can make the most money that you can make will only make sense. But in these literal weight classes, if I'd have fought Monty, I'd have took him out the game, or vice versa. You get what I'm saying?
Right. So it didn't really make no sense.
It wouldn't make no sense at all. We two local guys take two local guys fighting in two different weight classes, but we're gonna go. So what was the problem was, is that I wanted to venture off. I seen a different path for myself in a boxing game. And because I had the contract down there at Mountaineer, I controlled the money. So I was paying money. The company, we was paying money $2,500 a month to live off of without fighting. You get what I'm saying?
Now, when you say Mountaineer, for the people that don't know, are you talking about
casino
near right racetrack in West Virginia?
Yeah, correct. Mountaineer Racetrack and Game Resort. Yep, down there in West Virginia. So me and the owner, so I did a contract with the owner. His name was Ted Arnault. I did a contract with him, So every fighter, you need a promoter. So the promoter was the company in which Yankello and there's a couple other guys on there created, in which I signed to. So by law, if there's a contract, the fighter has a promoter, the promoter controls has to be the one to promote the fighter. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I control. So the promotional company, even though I had a contract down in Mountaineer, so I got guaranteed fights down in Mountaineer, right?
Right.
So who's going to promote them? So they created their own company, created the company, and gave me 25% of the company. And now we got a whole promotional company. So that locks up the whole venue. So Monty can fight, all the guys from Pittsburgh can get on the car, and they can sign those guys to the company on fight deals because of my contract. You get what I'm saying?
I wonder if that's why I never made them cards, because Brian wasn't letting me go nowhere.
Oh, I can guarantee you didn't make those cards because of that.
He wasn't letting me go nowhere, and he was pissed when Eddie Chambers Sr. took me from him and took me over to that other gym and started fighting and started training. Because I was done with down there in Wilkinsburg. He took me from down there. You see what I'm saying? So that's probably why you never saw me no more after that, because there wasn't no more reason for me to even be down there.
I want to say, I think Eddie fought on one of our cars, though.
Yeah, but see, that's what I'm saying. Eddie's dad, he couldn't have two heavyweight fighters.
Oh.
He wanted to focus, it was me and Eddie, he just wanted to focus on his son.
Oh, okay.
So he turned me over. That's exactly
what happened. And so the relationship, Eddie had the relationship with Yankello, and Brian didn't have the relationship with Yankello. Brian actually didn't like Yankello.
Right.
Brian didn't like
because he was taking people's fighters.
So that's why you didn't get on that card, because you have a promotional company, but then listen, at one time Mountaineer was the only venue to promote, that was promoting boxing, because they had the money. There was a casino, you know what I'm saying? And the only contract Mountaineer had was with me and the casino owner. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
I had a boxing contract with the casino owner. It was like X amount of fights a year, and I got paid on a month. So he was paying the company, I think it was like $25,000 a month without fighting. And then we were getting like 25% of ticket sales and stuff like that. But you weren't getting on them cards because you wasn't none of their fighters. You know, you wasn't none of Yankello's or those guys or Eddie Chambers fighters. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
Because Eddie fought on one of those cards.
Did his brother fight on one of those cards?
Yeah, he fought on the card too, but that's not his brother though. I know who you're talking about. Yeah, and his brother, bro.
And his name's Steve or Stevie?
Upshur. Yeah, they call each other brothers, but it's not really his brother. I know his mom.
Hey, man, Steve used to make them funny sounds out of his face, man, when he'd be boxing, man. He used to be like, kiss, 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 kiss.
Yeah.
He'd be like, man, why you keep doing? I used to laugh all the time. He used to be like, why you keep laughing at me, man? I used to be like, man, hold up, man. That shit's funny, man.
Like blowing air out your mouth.
Right, but then he started laughing at me when he was like, well, I'd laugh at your ass because you're the only one in the gym that trains the classical music.
Yo, yeah. Yeah. Matter of fact, yep, you were. You was listening to that old ass shit when we was in there working out.
I used to hit the heavy bag to that shit because I felt like if I can train my body to be to go through the most physical condition and stay calm and keep my mind calm, that'll happen in the ring. And that's how I ended up winning a lot of my sparring sessions because I used to always stay calm. I used to always think of that music. I didn't never think of rap. Rap music would have me too jittery and shit. Like that classical music shit would have me fucking calm as hell, man. And I was just I would put myself in that box of hearing that music. And then after that, I wouldn't care pretty much what happened at that point. But you know, shit happens. Like you said, man, life throw you a curve, man. I blew my knee out, shit. Life throw you a curve, man.
Yep. Life through your curve.
But, you know, now, all right. So now you got almost 200, you got about 200 amateur fights. So then you move up to the pros.
Correct.
Now when you fighting pro, because the minute you took that headgear off, I think that's when you became a complete savage. And I saw some of your shit, bro.
Yeah, I was good. I was decent.
You wasn't no damn decent, man. You was putting in some work.
Yeah, I put in some work.
Even Rui, I mean, you had to put in some work to win them belts.
Yeah.
And then, you know what I'm saying? And I seen with the interview with Rui, when Rui was speaking about you, man, he was like, yeah, you know, he came to do what he came to do.
Yeah, when I went down to the Roy's.
Yeah, when you was with Rui.
Yeah.
Now, what made you get with Rui Jones? How'd you get that?
Shit, I was on. So,
he being up from the casino.
No, listen. So being up under Rui, and that casino, and have my fights down the casino. In order for you to make some big bread, or you got to get noticed more. And that casino, being down there and having that venue. It was good, but Yankello and them, listen, this is where Yankello, but you gotta realize Yankello and them was learning too. They was learning, bro. They were young, you know, they were young promoters. Listen, that a lot of these fighters are even managers or promoters in the Pittsburgh area are young promoters. They don't really know we didn't really have the knowledge on how to get on that mainstream, that HBO deals. And I always wanted those big pay-per-view and HBO deals. So I knew that, man, listen, these boys gonna keep trying to shelter me. They were sheltering me. And me fighting I was only geared down to Mountaineer at the casino. It was sheltering me. And listen, if I'm, I gotta look at myself and listen, I'm a fighter. I'm a good fighter. I'm in this to make some bread and try to get up out of here. So listen, don't try to protect me. I just got to the point where I'm like, man, I'm not trying to protect myself. I'm not trying to, you know, because in their case, it was, okay, let's get him safe fight. Let's protect him. We could, you know, and just inch him up. Keep him winning, and then when a world title opened up, we could fight for a world title. Now we hold a belt, but it was all like safe moves. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I'm in it because there's a business, it's strategic. It's a business, you know. It's a business too. Boxing, you know. So it was strategic moves that they wanted to do. And then I got to the point where I was like, man, listen, it's either I got it. Or I don't. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So I had to go out there and try to listen. So I left when my contract ended down in Mountaineer Racetrack and Game Resort. I'm 21-1 and 4 or 3 right. Draws or something. So I had one loss, and 3 draws or something like that. But I had a belt, I was ranked, and I had no promoter. You know what I'm saying? I was free. I'm a free. The only person I had no promoter. Huh? Yeah, and I'm ranked in the world. I'm ranked in the world with no promoter, and not only that, I had crippled myself so much and not messing with no promoters that a lot of those guys, they weren't even messing with me. You said none of these promoters really wanted to do nothing with me because they felt like I was, you know, oh, they're just keeping him safe. They gonna keep him safe, and I'm like, nah. I had to learn all this once I ventured out on my own. I had to learn that, like, you know, I've been getting sheltered, bro. I was getting sheltered. I don't even know if I'm a dog. You know what I'm saying? Am I a dog? I mean, I was good in the amateurs, but am I really a dog? Because if I'm being sheltered, and you know, my opponents getting picked and everything, because. And reason why it's done that way is because if I'm the golden goose and I got the connection to all the money, you want to protect him. Because if your golden goose lose or something go wrong with your golden goose, now your money's out the door. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So let's keep him shielded. Let's shelter him until everybody else. Let's hope somebody else can get a can piggyback off of what he got going on and grab a world title or something, and then we can branch off. You get what I'm saying? It's strategic planning going on. But I got to the point where I'm like, man, listen, bro, listen. It was like, man, listen. I was like, I had a 5-year contract. I had a 3-year contract with Mountaineer, and I think, or a 4-year contract with Mountaineer, and then they gave me a year extension. So my contract went the same length as the casino, the CEO of, because those casinos, those CEOs are on contracts. You get what I'm saying?
Okay.
They're, even though they're CEOs, they're on contracts for that casino. There's a big board and everything. So that casino, that CEO is on contract for 4 years. And my contract ended when his ended. You know what I'm saying? So he gave me a contract for boxing, but he gave it to me till his time was up too. You know what I'm saying?
To make sure that he make him some money.
Yeah, it wouldn't carry on. Well, they didn't make no money. They made money off the casinos. How many people come to see? The casinos make money because they get to inflate a little bit of the price, probably on drinks and stuff. But they also, you know, they get the people paying those machines. That's it. That's why boxing and casinos go together, because the casinos will front up boxing money for like the purses and stuff.
Right.
They're gonna get it back with all the people that's gonna come down there. Cause after you watch the fight or before you watch the fight, you're gambling, you're buying drinks. You know what I'm saying? The money come back. So that's why majority of boxing is done in casinos. But okay, so I got to the point where I was like, man, I'm going out there, and I jumped out. That's what I did, and so I hooked up. I found out that Roy Jones. Had a mutual friend he went to school with in Ambridge. Ambridge, I'm from Bllackkoutt, and the person live in Ambridge. And one of our training camps where Roy Jones trained there too. So it was a guy who ran the training camp that linked me up with Roy Jones. He knew what I had going on, the guy that owned the training camp.
Right.
Being, you know, me having that whole deal down there, but I didn't have no promoter, no big name promoter to get me to launch me, to get me on a bigger TV. I wanted to go on HBO or on TV or something like that on the other side. I never had that big promoter to do that. So Roy Jones was training and up close, and he linked me up with Roy Jones. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So once he plugged me in, The very next day, when I spoke to Roy on the phone, I told him, yo, I'm flying out there. Because I had this contract with this casino owner. They was paying me $16,500 a month without fighting. Okay? I had this venue, and I got a, so they paying this bread. I got a matchmaker for the event, but now I'm like, yo, I gotta get a big promoter. I need a bigger promoter, man. Cause listen, stay off the street ain't really. They keep me, and I'm ready to. Listen, I want to see if I got it, motherfucker. Cause if I got it, let give me the big. I want to get in with the big dogs. Cause don't keep, because you it's wasting my time on other stuff that I'm trying to do. You get what I'm saying?
Yep.
Don't waste it. I don't want my time being wasted. I got tired of being. Listen, I didn't care about the money I was getting paid and protecting me and all like that, trying to trick somebody into, you know, no, I want, listen, no, if I got it, man, let me go, because if not, I could go on and move on to next, because, listen, I own the company. I own a property tax consulting firm in Houston, Texas. I can go on and do other stuff. Let my life go in, go off, you know what I'm saying? And let me get to what I'm doing now, you know what I'm saying? So when I brought in, so when I hooked up with Roy, and I had my first, I fought with Roy on my first card was in, what's that place called? Oh, man. It was a casino, an Indian resort, an old Indian resort, wherever that Indian resort was. Bllackkoutt, Mississippi. And I won first call with Roy, and then me and Roy did a contract after that. When I got that fight, me and him did a contract after that.
And that's when he started managing you.
Yeah, Roy, he never managed me. Roy gave me a promotional contract, but in retrospect, like the promotional contract, it was awesome, man. I'm gonna keep my word and keeping your word. See how me and Roy came up with that. Okay, so I own a company in Houston, Texas. Okay?
Right.
Well, Jay Prince. I don't know if you ever heard of Jay Prince.
Yeah, I know Jay Prince. The music dude.
That's right. So Jay Prince and Roy is close, okay? And I'm down there in Houston, and I was out there training in Jay Prince's gym. So everybody was connected. Everybody was connected. Like, I knew Jay, and then Roy. I didn't know Roy knew Jay. Roy knew Jay, and then Roy knew the dudes up here. So it was like, okay, I'm knowing all these. I know all the same. We all rolled in the same circle. You get what I'm saying? It was right. Like knew each other. So that's how me and Roy became closer, and because Roy knew. I ain't asked him for no money. I'm getting here on my own. You know, I had my own bread from the casino. I had that whole casino locked up. So I got the contract with the casino, and I'm like this. I wanted either Roy Jones or Jay Prince or them together to come to say, okay, come down here. I got this casino deal on lock. And listen, bring me the bigger fights. Let's do the bigger fights down at this casino, because they got the money. But they didn't see that vision. They didn't, you know, they wasn't, you know, it was too late. They didn't see that vision, because it could have been good. Listen, and the reason why I was doing that, because I wasn't just thinking about myself. There's other fighters in Pittsburgh. You get what I'm saying? I wanted to be able to put on those cards. Like, they can get, listen. I love boxing. I love, you know, boxing was a part of my life. I love boxing. But some people's, you know, as I started getting older, I started hanging around some wealthy business type men and some wealthy people. So, listen. I love boxing to death, bro. But listen, when your vision start changing, your alignment switches over. Now I started thinking about, man, listen, I started my property tax consulting firm in Houston, and I'm like, okay, I'm training to fight for this bread that I just made a day for in one day doing a job, you know, doing property taxes. You get what I'm saying? So right. It was like, man, shit, I can take property taxes. Shit, I'm a double triple of the bread on my own. You get what I'm saying? Like I don't need no way. Yeah. So it was like, so I got this contract, but I'm like, I still got some months left on this contract, and they paying me $16,000 a month, and I'm like, okay, I still got this contract, but then I got this company here, let me try to put other people in a better position and try to bring something together for this boxing. The consultant, the property tax was already where it is, and it's not going nowhere. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
So I was trying to leverage myself on what I wanted to, you know, where I wanted to go, what how I wanted to pay it. And they didn't see the vision. Like, it was too late for them. They probably had other stuff going on.
Now, is all this before you won the belt?
No, this is all during it. This was all during, this is after.
And okay, so all that was after you won the belt?
Yeah, all that was after.
Now,
I was ranked like 15th in the world at the time. So when you're ranked in one of the major, you know, the champ, whoever the champ is, has an option to pick 1 through 15 on a fight. And I had, like, I was supposed to fight, it was this dude from, well, damn, what country was he? He was number one at the time. Oh, shoot, I forget his name. But me and him was supposed to fight, but I didn't have no promoter or nothing. I had a matchmaker. I had a person that fought the fight for me, but I needed somebody. I wanted to be controlled the promoter. Listen, as a promoter, if you got a promotional contract and you got a promoter that's promoting you, he gonna get you on fights. And guess what else? Those fights, probably anything close, gonna go in your favor. He promoting you. That's why Floyd got both of them fighters. You get what I'm saying?
Why didn't you go with Floyd?
Who? With Floyd? Oh, me and Floyd. Me and Floyd didn't get along with each other.
What about Don King?
So let me tell you, I tried to hook up with them too.
Don King's a crook though.
But Floyd,
for y'all out there listening, I said it. Don King is a damn crook.
So I went. I flew down to Bllackkoutt TV. so I went out there. The first place I went before I went with Roy was to Floyd. I wanted Floyd to come in and take it. That's before I went to Roy. I flew down to Las Vegas because Mountaineer, the casino owner, owned the Binions in Las Vegas, okay?
Right.
So I went out there training. I went out there and I was training with, what's that heavyweight name? Well, he's a trainer now. And he trained me for one of my fights. They flew him in, paid him and everything. But I was out there training with him because I wanted to do something. I went out there so I can meet with Roger. I was out there with Roger and Floyd at first, but Roger, I don't know what the fuck. Roger, they on some street, like, hood type training. They was just too wild for me. It just wasn't like really organized.
What Roger are you talking about?
Mayweather.
Floyd's dad.
Who's Floyd's dad? That Floyd
Mayweather Senior.
Yes. So Mayweather, I was with Mayweather Senior, and it wasn't. Yeah, Roger's the uncle, right?
I think so.
Yeah, I was with Floyd. I was training with Floyd, the Senior, right? Yeah, I was training with Floyd's dad, and this was at the time when they wasn't getting along. It was like arguing. The dads, they weren't getting along. And I'm down there in Vegas, But I went before I started training with, I only trained with them for a week because I was like, man, they on some, I don't know what the fuck they was on. They on some, you know, like it was they were weird. It wasn't a fit for me, you know what I'm saying? And then I started training with Mike McCullen. Mike McCullen trained me for my fight. I was down to training for a fight. So Mike McCullen trained me for a fight. They flew Mike McCullen back down here to Mountaineer. Mike McCullen came down. Mike McCullen was the heavyweight. He's a heavyweight fighter back in the day. He fought a lot of good fighters. He was good trainer. I had the best fight of my life down there. Listen, and my training camp was a great training camp. Mike trained me. I trained and I partied every single day. That's what I'm telling you, bro. I had a limo because Ted Arnonum owned the casino. They owned that. So I had the limo so I was taking a limo to the boxing gym. You couldn't tell me shit.
Now is this before you got married?
Yeah, this is all before I got married.
Yeah, because the reason why I said that is because I got some questions I want to ask you.
Yes.
Now that you said that, but I don't want to, you know,
that story that goes in Vegas, stays in Vegas. Man, that's what I'm telling you. That's a true statement, brother. especially when they know you know, you got some bread and you know, you boxing or you're man. I'm talking about, and I had a penthouse suite. I was up on the top floor of the casino. So the way those casinos work, it's a corporation. It's like a corporation, and Ted Arnold owned the biggest. He's the biggest shareholder of the, I guess, the casino corporation.
Right.
So.
That's the Mountaineer owner, right?
Yeah, correct. Any one of those casinos that's up under that I guess casino
umbrella
jurisdiction or corporation. He was the main guy. He owned, you know, it was a board of directors and he owned majority share. So whatever, pretty much he got the call on what else to go. You know what I'm saying? Whatever. Right. Decision, he get to make the final call to, you know what I'm saying? So he had me stand out. So I said, man, I'm gonna go train in Las Vegas. I had a bad fight, and then I went out there to train in Las Vegas just to get a different look and different atmosphere.
Right.
And I trained out there, but listen, I really loosened up. I enjoyed training camp. I was training and I was partying. Like I was like, cause in my mind I'm like this. Listen, I was, bro. I'm talking about. I was in the clubs with Floyd, LeBron James, Carmelo Anthony. They was all out there in Vegas too. They was out in Vegas too, in their own limo. And that's when, cause I went down to the train with Rock it was Roger. I went down to the train with Roger. No, Floyd Senior. I'm sorry. I went down to the train with Floyd.
I was about to say Roger.
Yeah, no, I went down to the train with Floyd Senior. I was training with Floyd Senior, and Floyd Senior would come in the gym or whatever. But it was like he wasn't really like he was working, but it wasn't really working. Like I was sparring. And then I was like, man, fuck him. I started working with Mike McCullen. Mike McCullen started working with me too. And then but Floyd didn't know I had a fight coming up. Floyd Senior didn't know I had a fight coming up. And they was paying. Mountaineer was paying the Mike McCullen. So Mike McCullen trained me for that fight. And then I met Floyd. I never seen Floyd at the gym. I met Floyd in the club. Okay, Floyd was in VIP. And tell you what he did, bro. That's what I'm saying, man. Him ain't get along. I went up to him and I was trying, you know, I'm trying to say, yo, I'm down here training. I'm training with your dad. I was training with his dad. Yeah, it was his dad. I'm down here training with your dad. You know what I'm saying? I'm thinking he gonna like, yo, embrace me or whatever. Like, okay, you training with my dad. Come on, it's all love. You know what I'm saying? Man, listen, it was him and his, and he had this his bodyguard. And you know, I sat down, let him know, yo, I'm down here training with your dad and everything, or whatever. And then you know, I was like, man, I was trying to talk to him, so I was trying to let him know what I got. Look, my whole gimmick was I'm trying to get a bigger name down there to the Mountaineer joint to control it. Somebody that's, cause they plugged in for like HBO, ESPN, all those big. So I'm like, yo, I'm trying to get a plug. You know what I'm saying? That was my whole game. I got the bread. I'm trying to get a plug.
It sounds like you picked the wrong time to approach him.
Oh my gosh. That's what I'm telling you. He picked the wrong time whenever, because listen, I started talking to him or whatever, and then I turned around and was talking to LeBron and Carmelo for a second. And then when I turned back around, his bodyguard was like, Mr. Mayweather wants you out his VIP section. He wouldn't be out. He kicked me out.
What?
Yeah, he kicked me out. He was on some show. I just went to the next VIP section and was chilling with them. Cause listen, that wasn't my. I didn't know nothing about Vegas. I was down there trying to get a plug down, but then I knew it. Listen, and I told the pop like. Yo, your son's weird. Yeah, like he's kicked me out. Like I was just trying to talk to him about this deal, about something going on, and he just his head got me a. Man, it was. I'm down in this. Listen, you have realized this area wasn't known for boxing, so boxing wasn't big. We always trying to break into it, and I'm like, yo, this kid. See, Spatafor won one of the major world titles, bro. So he could have been able to bring those HBO deals, those big pay-per-views and stuff like that. But he started fucking up. He started, you know, he started messing up, getting high and all that, you know, weird stuff. So I get down. So then I started training with Mike Wickell. I won the belt. I came back here. Won a belt down back here, and then I never trained with Mike McCullough after that again. I went because I was trying to do something. I should have waited.
You should have waited, man. You can't talk a deal at the nightclub.
Oh man,
the only way you can talk a deal at a club is if you got Bill Gates money. Like if LeBron would have came in and sat next to Floyd and said, in the middle of a club and said, Floyd, I want you to do this commercial with me.
Oh, well, yeah. Got done.
He would have done. It was a done deal because LeBron got his kind of money, but you didn't have his kind of money.
No.
So Floyd looked at it like, nah.
No, I ain't had that kind of bread.
Right. But see, then again, that's why a lot of people said they didn't like Floyd, because they were saying that, man, he do that shit to a lot of people. You know what I'm saying? But I also hear on the other end of that he's good to a lot of people. You just got to pick your right time to approach him.
Yeah, I think he's a good dude, bro.
I wish you could have got with Tony Atlas.
Huh?
I wish you could have got with Tony Atlas.
Oh, yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Who motherfuckers who was training Tyson.
Well, listen. Okay, so... Before that, listen, I had burnt some bridges with Gary Shaw, Lou. Listen, so man, this is what I'm saying. I had burnt bridges with Gary Shaw, Lou Duva, and Shelley Finkel. So I had So I burnt Gary Shaw, Lou Duva. I think Gary Shaw. Gary Shaw was flying down here to see me. He was flying down here to see me, paying for my stuff from the Olympics and everything, man. And I like burnt him. You know what I'm saying? Like I was taking his bread, but I wasn't signing with him. I wasn't gonna sign with him.
Why?
Because I had other deals going. Like, I wanted to do something with somebody else. Like, I was taking this bread money. Now, I probably should have. Because, and then, yeah, I realized Jan Kello at the time was telling me, you know, we got different. They was trying to do their thing. So I'm being persuaded, too. But I probably should have messed with him. I think I should have messed with him.
Was you in the Olympics the same time as Ricardo Williams?
Yeah, Slick Rick. Yeah, Slick Rick was in there. Yeah, matter of fact, Slick Rick was messing with Shelly Finkel too. Slick Rick was messing with Jay Prince. Jay Prince. I think, yeah, it was more Jay Prince, though, than anybody. Slick Rick was messing with Jay Prince because they used to, listen, I'm Cincinnati boy, but they was doing some other stuff, too. They were doing some other stuff.
Hey, now, what I've come to learn was that if you find somebody who's on your side, you know what I'm saying, who treats you good, like they treat you like a family compared to treating you like just business. Do you think it's better to go with that person who treats you like family instead of getting with the person that's just about, because the person who's about business, yeah, they might can get you the big, like Don King.
Man, like, it depends on their situation. Man, you can't listen. You gotta realize you can't look at it like that because at the end of the day, this is a business. Everybody is business. These people livelihood.
So there ain't no friends involved.
No, you could be friends, but at the end of the day, listen, friends, being a friend shouldn't dictate if you, doing a good business deal with a person or not. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
Me and you talking. But at the end of the day, if we were going to do some business together, listen, you know my wife, whatever. At the end of the day, it got to make business sense. You get what I'm saying? Listen, that don't mean a person don't, if it don't make business sense, that don't mean a person don't like you or something that's good. It's you know what I'm saying? You can't mix them both.
Right, right.
It makes sense. And a lot of people, like when you're talking, a lot of times, you know, a lot of people probably want to mix them too. You can't mix with, at the end of the day. So Jan Kello, I left Jan Kello to go train somewhere else because I wanted, at the end of the day, because I had to start thinking, this is business. This ain't nothing personal with him. I love him as a person, as an individual, but at the end of the day, man, I'm trying to eat. I get that whole personal relationship, I got to put that on a hold for a second. I got to structure a lifestyle here for myself.
Right.
Because when boxing over, what I'm gonna say? I always been real to you. I gotta create something on your own. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
And the stuff you doing, I'm telling anybody, you wanna make sure you put yourself in a position too, regardless. So it ain't got nothing to do with no friendship. And I don't think a person that's that wants to do business should be ever get upset at another person for either putting themselves or trying to put themselves in a better position, in a position to, you know, benefit them. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
That's why
I asked you that, because so my viewers can, you know, they got sons that box and they got daughters that might box or play any kind of sport be any kind of an athlete, because this ain't just about boxing. This is about all sports.
Yeah.
So, you know what I'm saying? That's the main reason why.
Especially when you're trying to create a lifestyle.
Right, you know, right.
When you're trying to create a lifestyle.
Right. And see, they needed to hear that. But hearing me say it is one thing. but hearing it come from an actual champion
who
actually won belts and actually been through the whole merry-go-round of the network, like
the business
coming across crooked people, coming across people who try to get you in, set you up with fights that they know you ain't ready for, just so they can get the money and
correct.
You know what I'm saying? Yep. Like I done had trainers, man, try to get me, I didn't even know I was supposed to get paid for sparring. Pro fighter.
A lot of times, you can. Sometimes they do. Sometimes it don't. Depends on if you. You know, it depends on who it is. Yeah, you can.
You're supposed to get at least 50. You're supposed to get at least 50 a round. I found out.
Yeah, if they got a pro card and they fighting.
Right.
Yeah, if it ain't nobody that if this is training, but if they got a fight coming up and you're training for the fight, yeah, you should.
And guess what I found out? I also found out that all this sparring I was doing, my trainer was getting the money. I didn't even know. When I went over, when somebody got in my ear, and I went over to the other guy, and I was like, yo, man. I was like, I thought I was supposed to be getting paid for this. Listen, and you know what he said? Listen. Man, I already gave your peoples the money. That's what he said.
Yeah, I remember what's his name getting that money for you? I remember Brian Noel getting money for you for sparring. I remember that shit, bro. Matter of fact, yeah, Kello gave Brian because he needed him. You spar with Calvin. I know you spar with Calvin.
Calvin Brock?
Huh?
Talking about Calvin Brock?
Yeah.
Man, look.
Wait a second. It was either him or Abraham Okine, the dude from Africa. It was one of them dudes, man. It was one of those heavyweights. I remember you because Yan Kello had to pay Brian. Had to pay for that sparring.
I ain't getting nothing for that.
Yeah, he should have broke you. Yeah, he should have broke you off. Y'all should
get nothing for that, man.
Been eating together.
Well. But now this is what I want to know. All right. Before we let you go, we can't just let you go like that, man. We want to get into the mind of a champion.
Yeah, because you had me on. Let me say, ooh, wee. Go ahead.
Look, we need to get into the mind of a champion. That's how we're going to end this session.
Yeah, get in the mind. What's up?
In the mind of a champion.
Okay.
When you are the one with the belt and you're on that level of the game, how much pressure mentally is it and physically on you to try to stay on top for one? And for two, if you lose at that level, you lose your belt. Is that hurtful? Like, it's like how much, like, do you not want to be around anybody? Like, you just want to go somewhere and cry, or you know what I'm saying? Like, is it that hurtful?
Okay, so let me show you how to. I'm gonna give you a comparison, okay? Real quick, right? Right? You're on the highway, in both directions. Speed coming, well, how fast they going on the highway? 65, 70, some of them 70. Let's just say 70. 70. And you're on the highway and the cars are loaded and everybody's doing 70 and you trying to dodge cars. So that's how much pressure it is. It's a lot of pressure. You're trying to survive. You're trying to live. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So this is... But the pressure comes off of both ends, the boxing end, and listen, at the end of the day, you still got to get in the ring and fight. That's the most, and the fighting part is the easier part. You know what I'm saying? It's all the business behind it that keeps people's minds. Listen, it's the business part that keeps people's minds. If I had two of me. If I had two of me, I'd have had a better career.
Well, being at the top of the game like you was, and this is how we're going to end the show, because everybody's been waiting for this interview. I've been telling everybody about it. It's finally here. Verquan, the show, Kimbrough, was at the top of his game, at your prime.
Yep. And
in your own words, can you tell the viewers what happened?
I got hit by a commercial truck.
Was it like a car accident?
I was in a car accident. Yeah, I was in a car accident. I mean, I planned on, I was on the end of my career. Anyway. Man, listen, I was on the end of my career. Listen, so let me tell the viewers this. I made preparations. So I'm not naive enough to think, you know, or trust into a sport in which you can get hurt at any given moment, that you can get hurt at any given moment and ruin your whole, just put a damper in your whole progress of development, in your just being an asset to your family. So I never been that naive. So I made preparations for any, I made sure that I was, I had things I was able to do, or that I was doing when I got into this boxing, what I was going into, so these type of occasions happen. Okay, so I couldn't fight no more. I ain't miss no beat. I make more money outside the ring than I did in the ring. You get what I'm saying?
Right.
Not putting the emphasis on the money, because I mean,
did you have to give the belts away? Did you have to give the belts back?
No, you keep them belts. They just make belts over. Once you win them, they're yours.
You still got your belts?
Yeah.
Can we see them?
Yeah, let me see if I can. Let me see if I got them. Hold on, let me see where they at. I think they like, man, I'm talking about, them things are like, I think they're down here. You see them going downstairs? They're in a basement.
Man, you should have them on the wall.
Let me see. They liking it, huh? No, let me show you what's on the wall, though. You see that picture right there on the wall?
Yeah.
Huh? That one right there on the wall? My man right there, me and, you see who that is?
Yeah, get a little closer.
That's Sugar Ray.
Oh, okay.
Daddy, why are you down
okay
here?
That was the casino owner right there that gave me my deal. Him. Did you see him?
Yeah.
So let me see here. Let me see if I... they these things is tucked away. Let me see if I can fish them out back here. Okay, yeah, here they go. Look, they how many?
Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to see Verquan, the show, Kimbrough's belt.
See that right there? World champion. Nigga, one. Let me see. So that was the NABC belt right there.
Woo!
NABC. That was two NABC belts. And that's just another organization. This is the IBA. That was a world title right there. Right there. No, let me see. This one was a WBA. See WBA on there. That's WBA.
That's what we talking about.
A
champion.
And then there's a couple more. You got this is the international one. That one.
Hey, Hey, let's get a photo of you holding all your belts up, man.
Man, I can't get all of them. Man, that's it. Man, you know what I mean? Belts.
Come on, man.
Shit is more. Man,
for me, man. It's for me.
Man. Oh, my gosh, bro. You killing me. Hold on. I got to put my phone on it.
Yeah, you thought this interview was going to be easy, didn't you?
Huh?
You thought this interview was going to be easy, didn't you?
Yeah, let me see if I can still make something happen. Shit, I can't even fit these windows no more. Damn, look at that, man. I forgot they still was out back here. These things used to be in the bird, too. I used to have them out in Pittsburgh.
That's what I'm talking about.
Like this.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are witnessing a champion. A former champion.
They everywhere.
On the show, Kimbrough. It is really him. It is not an imposter.
That's it. I can't put them all on. I can't carry them.
Hey, we appreciate you even showing us, bruh.
Yeah. Listen, if I was in Las Vegas, what Floyd Mayweather did down here. But it's just what the venue wasn't as big as Floyd's. Vegas got big money.
Hey man, I can't wait to do that interview with your cousin in the WNBA. You gotta hook that up, man.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, with Shatori.
Yeah, you gotta hook that and Roy.
Yeah. My phone about to die.
Is your uncle still living?
Who?
Tony Dorsett.
Is he still where? I don't know where yet.
Oh, he's still alive?
Yeah, alive.
Well, I mean, you know, because you hear a lot of stuff, man, with, like, Walter Payton and all that, man.
That PSD or something they get?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man, yo, man, you gotta line those up for me, man.
All right. I can try to help you out somehow.
Man, I'm kind of like you was in the club trying to talk to Floyd, bro. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to put something together, bro. You know what I'm saying?
Floyd played me.
You ain't going to do me like Floyd did you, though, is you?
No, because I don't want nobody to know Floyd. Damn. Listen, all I can do is try. I tried, though. I had a good little gimmick. Man, that shit would have went, boy. That shit would have been on. That shit would have been on. Oh, honey. Oh. But you know.
You ain't, what's that, some dog food?
And I think, listen, because Floyd, like a lot of people, would need Floyd. You know what I'm saying? But at the time, man, I ain't need Floyd. I have my own bread.
Well, I tell you one thing, man. You're looking good, bro. You're looking healthy. You're looking like you still can put them together. You know what I'm saying?
Shit. Yeah, my wife making me fat.
I wish you come down and visit, you know what I'm saying, so you can get some work on this right here, you know what I mean? Get some work on this right here.
On that heavy bag.
Yeah. Come on down to my gym, man. Put in a little, you know. Put
where your gym work. At?
Huh?
Where your gym at?
Inside my house.
Where you live at, bro?
In Dayton.
Dayton, Ohio?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I used to go down there. I used to be down there.
I'm telling you, man, you gotta come down, man. Get your workout on.
All right,
we gotta start hanging out, man. We gotta start, you know what I mean?
For sure. All right, I'm out. Let me get off of this phone, buddy.
All right, bro.
That's
hey,
it. That interview
if
over.
Out there like the video y'all just saw. If you like the interview, you know what to do. We was here talking for an hour and a half with the one and only Verquan, the show, Kimbrough.
For sure.
Tuning in to Bllackkoutt TV. Hit the like button. Hit the subscribe button. Also, leave some comments. Hit that notification button. Ring that bell. You know what I'm saying? Yo, this is Tony Bllackkoutt Williams with Bllackkoutt TV, Verquan, the show, Kimbrough. We'll see you again. Peace.
Peace out.